Good morning, viewers. In today's class, we shall learn about the design of tension members. In previous classes, we have seen how to design beams, compression members, and column bases. In the design of tension members, we shall start with the definition of tension members, the types of structural members that can be used for tensional members, and we shall see how to calculate the net effective sectional area and the permissible axial stress in tension. Then we shall see the actual procedure of design of tension members. Now, if you have any queries, please post the questions after half an hour of the class. Now, to begin with, now we should know what is a tension member. A tension member is defined as, please look at this slide, a tension member is defined as a structural member subjected to tensile force in the direction parallel to its longitudinal axis. That is, whenever the load is applied along its longitudinal axis, then a member is said to be a tension member because only pure tensile stresses will act. Look at this figure. Now, this is a tension member. Now, this dotted line in red represents the longitudinal axis of the member. And you see, this is the pull or the tensile force that is applied on either side. So, since this force is acting along its longitudinal axis, then this member is subjected to pure tensile stresses only, and all the area is effectively taken by these tensile stresses. Suppose instead of applying the pull along the longitudinal axis, we apply at a distance away from the longitudinal axis, then along with the axial tension, the member will be subjected to bending also. So, due to the eccentricity, bending is also caused, and the member should be designed both for tension as well as bending. So, it is always preferable that we apply the load along its longitudinal axis only. Now, we said a tension member is a member that is subjected to tensile pull or tensile load. Now, do we have any other names of the tension member? Yes. Tension member can be called as the tie member or simply a tie. Instead of always calling it as a tension member, we usually refer tension members as tie members. Sometimes we just say a tie. This nomenclature of tie is mostly used in the roof trusses. So, whenever a roof truss, we are specifying a tension member, we say a tie in the roof truss. Now, once we know what is a tension member, we should know how these tension members are made up of, or what are the different types of steel sections that are used to get the tension members. So, look at this slide. There are basically four types of tension members. The first one is the wires and cables. So, we can use wires and cables for tension members. Similarly, we can also use rods and bars. The third is single structural shapes and plates. Like, what we mean by single structural shapes? It can be angle sections, it can be T sections, it can be channel sections. And the plates, why do we use them? Plates are basically used for making connections. Then we have the last variety, that is the built up members. Now, what are these built up members? When we have large pull that is applied and the sectional area required is enormous, which cannot be catered by single sections, then we go for the combination of two or more sections. So, such a combination of structures is known as built up members. Now, we shall see the uses of all these members in detail. First, let us see about the wires and cables. Now, coming to wires and cables, the wire ropes They are long ropes of a small cross sectional area. So these generally have lot of flexibility. So due to their flexibility nature, the wire cables are exclusively used for hoisting purposes. They can also be used for gay wires in steel towers which are used for transmission, and also as hangers for suspension bridges. So in suspension bridges they serve the purpose of hangers, whereas in transmission towers they are used as gay wires. And apart from this, the cables can also be used for suspension bridges. Now wires and cables, as we said, they are more flexible. They cannot be used in structures where some rigidity is required. So when more rigidity is required, we go for selection of other type of members. Now let us look at the second variety of the members. The second variety of the members are bars and rods. Now steel bars and rods can also be used for tension members. Now the cross section of the bars can be flat, they can be square, or we can use a round bars. These bars, they are provided with threads at the ends and they are given with nuts so that we can make the connection simpler. Now where are these used? These bars and rods are often used in bracing systems. So when we require to brace the columns or other types of bracing systems, we can go for this flats, rods and bars. Apart from this, they can be used as sag rods to support purlins in between two trusses, to support the grids in industrial buildings and in the sections where the weight is a major consideration. Suppose we require a huge structure, then if you go on adding on heavy members, the self weight of the structure itself will go up enormously. So in order to reduce the self weight, we have to opt for light members. So when there is an option for light members, we can use the rods and bars. Now coming to the third type of members which can be used, these are called single structural shapes and plates. Now what are the single structural shapes? In previous classes we have seen that structural steel can come in various shapes like angles, T's, channels and also I sections. So you can use one of these single sections for the tension members. The angle sections are most widely used for tension members. Now you can look at this figure. Now here this is a single T member with a flange. Now here the connection is usually made to the flange. So this flange is connected to a flange rod on the top, and we have a rivet here and also one more rivet here. So that completes the connection. Or you can use a single angle where one leg, either you can connect this leg to a gusset plate that is provided here, or you can connect this particular plate with a gusset plate and a rivet. So that will be a single angle connected through one leg. So you can use T sections or angle sections. Now apart from using angle sections and T sections, as I said, the availability of channel sections can also be considered if the loads are in medium quantities and where you require more rigidity that is offered by the angles. So channel sections can also be used for single sections which can cater for the tension members. So why these are used? The main purpose of using a channel section is you can have more rigidity in direction of web and you can have low rigidity in direction of flange. Now apart from using channel sections, we can also use the I sections. Now I sections are the best options when the load is very large and where high rigidity is required. So these are about the single structural shapes that can be used as tension members. Now coming to the last category, that is the built up members. So what are built up members? As I've said, built-up members are the members which consists more than one section. You can have a combination of angles and gusset plates. You can have combination of channels and angles. You can have a combination of different steel structural members. Now, when are these required? The built-up members are primarily required when a single rolled steel section cannot furnish the required area. So, when the area required is very large and when a single structural member cannot suffice for this area, then you have to go for a built-up section. Now, what is the advantage of using built-up sections? The built-up sections, as you see at this slide, the built-up sections, they offer more rigidity, they offer more stiffness, and they can resist compression if reversal of stresses takes place. So, what do we mean by reversal of stresses? Basically, we are designing the member to withstand tension. Suppose by chance or by the combination of loading, instead of tension, compression occurs in the member, then the member should be able to resist the compression also. If there is a reverse of stress, instead of compression you have tension, or instead of tension you have compression, the member should be sufficiently capable of withstanding the stresses that are occurring due to the loading. So, that is called the reversal of stresses. So, a built-up member is an excellent option when you have more rigid structures, when we require more stiffness, and also in situations where we require the member to withstand reversal of stresses. Now, let us see what are the options for built-up sections. Look at this. We can use two angle sections that can be placed back to back on the same side of the gusset plate or back to back on the opposite side of the gusset plate. Now, look at this figure. Now, this is one angle section. This is one more angle section. So, these two angles, they are connected to the plate. So, this plate is called a gusset plate. A gusset plate is basically a plate which is used for making connections. So, how are they connected? They are connected by rivet on one side and the other rivet on the other. So, the connection is through the rivets. So, you can have an option of two angles on the same side. Now, you see this is the gusset plate. So, angles are on the same side of the gusset plate. Now, we can have one more option of connection, like instead of connecting to the same side of the gusset plate, we can connect to the opposite sides of the gusset plate. Look at here, this particular section. Now, this is the gusset plate used for connection. Now, here we have one angle and here is one more angle. Now, look at the connection. The angle is on the left side and this is on the right side. So, they are on the opposite sides of the gusset plate. This particular combination or this particular type of arrangement is very well suited because the eccentricity in such connection is minimum. If you go to the previous slide, look at the previous one. Now, here there is a possibility of eccentricity in one direction because it is not uniform on both axes. Whereas, if you go to the connection on either sides of the gusset plate, there is uniformity in the connection and the eccentricity is avoided. Now, we shall see some more connections. Before that, the double angles are mostly used in roof trusses. The two angle sections, they are basically used as tension members in the roof trusses. Now, we shall see some more connections for built-up sections. Now, look at this figure. Now, here we have, as we have seen, these are the two angles connected back to back. And here we have two channels. So, this is a one channel, this is one channel. Now, you can have a gusset plate in between, or you can maintain this distance. In some situations, we require the distance to be maintained. In such situations, you can use the channel sections wide apart. Channel sections are basically used when we have medium loads. When we have small loads, we go in for the angle sections, that is double angle sections, and channel sections are used for mild or medium loads. Now coming to the next type of connections. Now here you can see we are having four angles. This is one angle, this is the other angle, this is the third one, and this is the fourth. How are they connected? They are connected with two parallel gusset plates. So such connections or such type of members are used for moderately high loads. Now, let us see one more type. Now here you see they are placed at a distance apart, both of them facing opposite to each other, and in this type again you have four angles forming two T sections. We shall see some more. So here you have a star connection where the angles are placed with the opposite gusset parallel plates with a connecting plate on the top. We have one more thing. Now here you have a middle gusset plate to which you have two angles on either side or opposite faces on one side. Similarly, we have two angles on opposite face of this gusset. So forming, or instead of using two angle sections, you can use a single T here and also single T here. Now let us see one more type of connection. Now here you see, now here one gusset plate, two and three. So we are using three gusset plates to which four angles are connected. So instead of using four angles and three gusset plates, we can do with the I sections also, as we have seen the next one. So once we have seen how the connections are made to make up the built up sections, which can offer more rigidity, more stiffness, and cater to reversal of stresses, the next issue we have to discuss is the net sectional area. What do we understand by net sectional area? Now when we try to provide, or when we try to resist the load can be resisted by the area that it is acting upon. So the area that we generally specify is the gross cross sectional area. Now since we are making connections with rivets, there are bound to be holes in the members that we are going to provide. Now due to the provision of holes, the area is reduced, the total area is reduced by formation of the holes. So in order to the section to take up the stresses effectively, we cannot consider the gross cross sectional area. So we have to always take the net sectional area. Now how do we define net sectional area, or what is the net sectional area? Look at the slide. Net sectional area of a tension member is the gross cross sectional area of the member less the sectional area of maximum number of holes. That is, net sectional area is gross sectional area minus sectional area of holes. So if you deduct the area of holes present in the section, then you are going to get the net sectional area. Now how are we going to calculate the sectional area of the hole? A hole is assumed, or the projected area of a hole is assumed to be a rectangle. Now look at this, the projected area of each hole is a rectangle, one side of which is the thickness of the member and the other side is the diameter of the hole. So a rectangle with one side as the diameter of the hole and the other side as the thickness of the member gives us the area of the hole. Now let us try to calculate, or first let us see why we have to calculate the net sectional area. What is the consideration? Look at the slide. The area of steel is reduced due to presence of hole. So when we take a member and try to make connections, we make holes, so the area of steel is reduced. Now what happens if the area is reduced? When the area is reduced, naturally the load will be constant. So what happens? The stress will increase. So that's what is here. The unit stress in tension is increased due to the reduced area of steel for the same load. Now, due to the increase in stress, what happens? The stress is concentrated along the surface of the hole. So that's what is here. Stress concentration occurs along the edges of the holes. So to cater to all these needs, we cannot take the cross sectional area, but we have to take only the net sectional area. Now, how are we going to calculate this? The calculation of net sectional area is given in Bureau of Indian Standards for Steel Structures, that is IS 800 section 4. Now, what is it? Let us see. The net sectional area for plates. Now, if you are going to take plates for the tension members, then how are we going to calculate its net effective area? The net sectional area of plate is obtained by deducting the area of rivet holes from the gross cross-sectional area of the plates. That is, the gross cross-sectional area of the plate minus the area of the hole, we are going to get the net effective area. Now, I shall explain this with the help of a small example. Now, let us see this example. Let's see. Now, this is a plate in which we are having a continuous line of holes. So, if you take any section ABCD, then what will be the net area here? The gross area minus the area of these two holes. Now, the area of this member. Now, if B is the width of the plate and T is the thickness of the plate, then the gross cross-sectional area is B into T. Now, what is the sectional area of holes? We have to generalize, I have taken n number of holes. Instead of 6, I can have 8, 2, 3, it may vary according to the situation. So, to generalize, n we have taken as the number of holes, and the area of each hole is the diameter of the hole multiplied by the thickness. Just to simplify, we get B minus ND into T. So, this is how we calculate the net area of a plate which is having chain riveting or continuous holes or symmetrical holes. Now, let us take one more example. Now, look at this figure. In this figure, we have the same plate, but look at this holes, they are not symmetrical, they are zigzag. So, we have 3 here, 2 here. If you take a straight cross section here, we get only one hole, whereas if we consider a section A, B, D and E, the section is having 2 holes. So, whenever we have a zigzag hole pattern, then the net area is given as gross area minus sectional area of hole minus P1 square by 4G1 plus P2 square T by 4G2, where P1 is the pitch, or pitch is the vertical distance between these two holes, and G is the gauge, that is the horizontal distance between these two holes. So, if you simplify, we are going to get BT minus NDT plus N dash into P1 square by 4G into T, where P is the staggered pitch, N is the number of holes in zigzag line, N dash is the number of staggered pitches. Now, let us see about the net effective area for single angle connected through one end. That is, look here, we have only one angle member which is connected to a gusset plate. So, this is the gusset plate. How is the connection made? Through a rivet. So, the leg that is connected to the gusset plate is called the connected leg, and the leg which is not having any connection is called the unconnected leg or the outstanding leg. So, in this case, how are we going to find out the net effective area? If you closely observe this connection, we can say that there is an eccentricity in the x direction. So, this section is subjected to some eccentricity. So due to this eccentricity, the net effective area shall be reduced. What is the criteria for reduction of this? This is given in the section 4.1.1 of the IS 800 1984. So according to this, the net cross-sectional area will be equal to the cross-sectional area of the connected leg plus the cross-sectional area of unconnected leg multiplied by a constant k. Now what is this constant k? K is 3a1 by 3a1 plus a2, where a1 is the effective cross-sectional area of connected leg, a2 is the gross cross-sectional area of the unconnected leg. If you go back to the previous slide, so this is the unconnected leg or the outstanding leg. So the area of this leg is a2 and area of this connected leg is a1. So now once we know this, now let us move on to the next section. Now here we have a pair of angles back to back or a single T connected by one leg only or by flange of T to the same side of the gusset. Now you look here, we have two angles which are connected by only one leg. See, this is the connected leg and this is the unconnected. There is a small mistake here. This is the unconnected leg, this is the connected leg. So the connections are made to the gusset plate through the rivets. So in this case, now we said there is symmetry on either axis and there is no eccentricity. So in this case, how do we calculate? The A net is equal to A1 plus A2K. So here A1, we said it is the area of connected leg, A2 is the area of unconnected leg, and K is a constant, which is equal to 5A1 by 5A1 plus A2. Now we shall see the same double angles connected to the gusset in a different fashion. Now look here, for double angles or flange of T placed back to back and connected to each side of a gusset plate. Now here we see, this is the gusset plate. So we are having one angle section on the left, the other angle section to the right. So in the starting itself, I told you this is the most preferred connection because we have symmetry both on x-axis as well as y-axis. So here we calculate the effective area as the gross area of the members minus the sectional area of the holes. So the area of these two angles minus the area of this hole will give you the net effective area. The Bureau of Indian Standards says, whatever we have discussed, the way of finding out the net effective area, it is valid provided we have stitch riveting throughout. In case we don't have tacking rivets or stitch rivets, then how do we do? Look at this slide. When the angles are placed back to back and tacking rivets are not used to connect the angles along their length, then each angle shall be designed as single angle connected through one leg only. That is, even though you are having two angles connected back to back, if there is no stitch riveting, we shall design them as a single angle connected through one leg only. So this is how we find out the net sectional area of the members. Now once we know how to calculate the net sectional area, the next problem arises of calculation of axial tensile stress. So how much should we take? This is solved by the Bureau of Indian Standards for Steel Structures. Here in the clause 4.1.1, it is clearly given that the axial tension, look at the slide, the axial tension, which is given by sigma at, sigma denotes stress, at is the axial tension on net effective area of the section, shall not exceed 0.6 times Fy. Now what is Fy? Fy is the minimum yield stress of steel. So So depending upon the grade of steel we are going to use, we have to take the minimum yield stress, which is denoted in megapascals, or 1 megapascal is nothing but 1 newton per mm square. So we know how to calculate the net effective area, and we have got the calculation of the axial tensile stress from Bureau of Indian Standards. So now we are ready to calculate the strength of a structural member. Now what do we understand by strength of a structural member? Strength of a member is its load carrying capacity. How much load a member can carry safely, that is denoted by the strength of the member. Now look at this slide. The strength of a member is given by PT. So PT denotes the strength of a member in axial tension. This is equal to the net effective area multiplied by the axial tensile stress. So now we have seen how to calculate the net effective area, and we have also seen how to calculate the net the axial tensile stress. So we are ready to calculate the load or the strength of a member. Now shall we go for a small problem for calculation of the strength? So look at this problem. A double angle tie, Indian standard angle 150 by 75 by 10 mm at a weight of 0.169 kilonewtons per meter with short legs back to back of a roof truss is connected to the same side of a gusset with 18 mm dia rivets such that each angle is reduced in section by one rivet hole only. Determine the tensile strength of the member. Stitch rivets have been provided at suitable spacing. Assume value of yield stress used as 250 newtons per mm square. So here we are given two angle sections of ISA 150 by 75 by 10 with short legs back to back on same side of the gusset. So now let us start solving this. Now how do you find the hole dia or dia of the hole? Now the dia of the hole is taken as the dia of the rivet plus 1.5 millimeters. So this works out to be 19.5 millimeters. So here we said it is connected back to back on same side of the gusset. Now let us start calculating the net effective areas. So the connected leg, now the connected leg, the length is reduced by one hole. So 150 minus one hole minus half the thickness. So this is the effective length available multiplied by thickness. So this is the area of one connected leg. We have two such angles, so multiply by 2, which comes to 2510 mm square. Now let us calculate the area of unconnected leg or the outstanding legs. Now outstanding leg A2, here we don't have any hole, so we are not going to deduct any area for the hole. So this is the length minus half the thickness, so the net length available multiplied by the thickness of the member. So this will give you the one area. We have two such legs, so multiply by 2, this works out to be 1400 mm square. Then we are going to calculate the constant, which is equal to 5A1 by 5A1 plus A2. So it works out to be 0.8996. Now the net effective area is A1 plus A2K. So if you simplify, we are going to get 3769.493 millimeter square. Now once we are calculating the net effective area, next thing we are supposed to do is to find out the stress in axial tension. We are given that the grade of steel used is 250. So the minimum yield strength will be 250 newtons per mm square. So look at the slide. The axial stress in tension is 0.6 times Fy. So it is 0.6 times into 250. So this works out to 150 newtons per mm square. So the tensile strength is the net effective area multiplied by this stress. So net effective area multiplied by the stress, we get 565423.95 newton. So we divide this by 1000 to get 565.423 kilonewton. So this is the strength of the member. So now we have, till now we have seen what are the members used for tension members, how to calculate the net effective area for each of these members, and how to take the axial permissible stress. Now knowing the tensile stress and the net effective area, we have also seen how to calculate the strength of a member. So this comes under analysis part. Now in the design part, we are supposed to design a section. So designing a section means choosing an appropriate section which can carry the given load. Now let us go to the design procedure of a tension members. So for a design procedure, we are given the pull or the load to be carried. We are also given the axial tensile stress, and we are required to find out the member, what are the sections used, how the connections are made, and whether the member we have chosen is safe or no. So to proceed with the design, we follow the following steps. Please look at this slide. Now for a design of tension members, the main data we are given are the axial pull to be transmitted by the member, axial pull or the load to be carried. We are also given the allowable stress in axial tension. Now with these two, that is the load to be carried and the axial tension, we can calculate the net sectional area. So the net sectional area is equal to the total load to be transmitted or the axial pull divided by the allowable stress in axial tension. So now we get the net sectional area required. Now from this net sectional area, we have to find out the gross sectional area. So how do we find? We have to make allowances for the sectional area lost due to the provision of holes. So to find out the gross sectional area, we increase the net area by 25% to 40%. So by increasing this, we come at a conclusion of a gross sectional area. So once we have come to a conclusion of how much we have to provide, then we refer to steel tables and find out what are the sections which can give us this cross sectional area, and then we select one suitable type of section. So the suitable section from steel tables is selected. Now once you have selected the section, again you have to decide upon what are the connections you are going to give and what is the net area that you are going to provide. So that is what we are going to do. The net connections of the tension members are designed, and again the net area is calculated. So we know the gross cross-sectional area of the member that we have selected. From this we know, or we have decided upon, what type of connection we are going to provide. So we know how many holes are going to come. So we deduct the area of these holes from the gross sectional holes, gross sectional area. So we arrive at the sectional area provided. Now we compare the net area provided to the net area required, and if this is more, then the design is safe. Otherwise we change the section. Now once the section is safe, then we check for slenderness ratio. Now what is the slenderness ratio? Slenderness ratio of a tension member is the ratio of its unsupported length to the least radius of gyration. We denote slenderness ratio by lambda, that is equal to L by R minimum. So here we have radius of gyration in xx direction and yy direction. We shall choose the minimum and provide the minimum here. Now what are the limits? According to Bureau of Indian Standards, that is IS 800, a tension member which is subjected to reversal of stresses other than wind or seismic forces should not be more than 180. And for a tension member which is subjected to reversal of stresses due to wind or seismic forces. What are seismic forces? These are earthquake forces. So if this is the case, then the slenderness ratio shall not exceed 350. So now we are ready to design a problem. Let us see small design problem. This is the problem given to you. Design a single angle section for a tension member to carry a pull of 100 kilonewtons. The member is subjected to possible reversal of stresses due to action of wind. The length of the member is 3.5 meters and the stress is given as 250 newtons per mm square. So we are given the load, we are given the Fy, so we can calculate the axial tension. So the permissible axial tension is 0.6 times Fy, that is 0.6 times 250, which works out to 150 newtons per mm square. So the net effective area required will be the tensile load given by the permissible stress, so which works out to be 666.67 mm square. So now once we know the net effective area, we shall decide on the connection and then find out the cross sectional area. So since he said we have to use only single angle section, we shall increase by 40% and then calculate the cross sectional area. So here we are increasing by 40% and the cross sectional area is 1.4 times the net area. So which works out to be 933.34 mm square. So we keep this in view and go to the steel tables and find out the sections or the angle sections which can give us the sectional area of 933. So if you work out, there is one section that is ISA 65 by 65 by 10 mm which gives us the gross cross sectional area of 1200 mm square and the least radius of gyration is 12.5 mm. Now let us assume 18 mm diameter rivets and the single angle section, let us assume it is connected to a gusset plate by one angle only. Then the net effective area is A1 plus A2k, where A1 is the area of connected leg. So this 65 mm is the length of one leg. So we have one rivet hole, so we have to subtract this, minus half the thickness. This is the effective length available into the thickness. So this is the area, it's multiplied by 2. So we get 405 mm square. Now similarly, we shall calculate the area of outstanding legs. So the area of outstanding legs are 2 into 65 minus 10 by 2 into 10, which works out to be 600 mm square. Then we calculate the constant, which is equal to 3A1 by 3A1 plus A2. So it works out to be 0.669. Now the net effective area will be A1 plus A2K. So A1 is the connected leg area. This is the area of unconnected leg multiplied by the constant, which works out to be 806.65 mm square. Now this is the net area provided, whereas the required area is only 666.67. So we are providing an area of 800 mm square, the required area is only 666. Will the section be safe? Will it be or no? It has to be safe because we are providing more sectional area than required. Now once the member is safe in the carrying the load in this area aspect, we have to check whether it is safe for slenderness also. Now let us check that. the slenderness ratio that is given by lambda. So lambda is L by R minimum, that is L is the effective length, that is 0.85 times 3.5 into 1000. We are converting this into mm because we have taken the least radius of gyration in millimeters. So 0.85 into 3.5 multiplied by 1000. So that works out to be, this is divided by again least radius of gyration. So it works out to be 238. The ratio is 238, and the maximum permissible ratio that we have seen earlier, that is whenever a tension member is subjected to reversal of stresses due to wind or seismic, that is the earthquake forces, then the maximum limit is 350. So the slenderness ratio calculated is 238, whereas the slenderness ratio, the maximum permitted is 350. Now will the member be safe? It has to be safe because the maximum limit is 350, but the calculated slenderness ratio is only 238. So we have found that the member we have used is safe for carrying the load, and also it is safe for slenderness ratio, that is its net effective area that is required, we have provided more than required, that is the required area was only 666 mm square, whereas we have provided 806 mm square. So it was safe in that aspect, and the slenderness ratio is also less than the 350. So we can conclude that the design is satisfactory. So provide ISA, that is Indian standard angle, 65 by 65 by 10 mm, at the weight of 0.094 kilonewtons per meter as tension member. In today's class we have seen what is a tension member, what are the different structural members that can be used as tension members, how we can calculate the net sectional area, and basically why we should consider net sectional area, then how to calculate the net sectional area for different types of connections. We have also seen how to calculate the permissible stress in axial tension. Now knowing the net sectional area and permissible axial tension, we have found out the strength of the member in tension. This was the analysis part. Then in the second part we have seen how we can design a tension member. Now we shall continue the design of steel structures with the topic of roof trusses in the coming class. Thank you.